Welcome to What the Flicks review of The Walking Dead, Season 4, Episode 12. Still, double meaning there. I'm Kim Horcher, and I'm joined by John Iderola and the Nerd Alert Army of Andrew Fogel and Tim Frisch.
Not in that order.
She's not sure who's who, but she'll figure it out.
I'll eventually figure it out. I have blindness to people. Anyway, speaking of blindness, last night's episode revolved completely around Beth and Daryl, and Beth's simple premise of, I need a drink. And of course, it becomes one of those great, or maybe not great in your opinion, character study episodes. And we learned so much more than we'd ever known before about both those characters. So let's start off the top.
Yeah, is this like the fewest characters that have been featured since like season one? Like before Rick?
I think it is, yeah.
Yeah, it was very different.
All the other episodes that we've seen recently have been like two characters and then cutting back to two other characters.
Like at least Michonne and Rick and Carl or something
just
like that.
Committed to the two of them.
You know, it seemed like an odd pairing at first, Beth and Daryl, but I liked it overall because they both have, I feel like they both kind of have a chip on their shoulder about who they were before the turn, as they say. And they were kind of discovering this whole episode of, you know, letting go of who they were and becoming who they are, which I loved. But it did revolve around the premise of Beth wants a drink, and she knows this sounds stupid, but they're doing it anyway. Because I think she needs kind of like a goal. Because at the end of the world, what's going to happen? You're just going to be wandering around. They think everyone they know is dead. So maybe let's lessen the existential dread a little bit and make a little mission for ourselves.
Yeah.
Let's go to the country club and get some cardigans and and hit a few brains.
Play darts?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that long term you need to find something more fulfilling than just getting drunk, but in the short term, at least following like whatever impulse you have is something to do, something more than just eating a snake, for instance. And when she said, you know, I want to get a drink, I thought it was going to be, oh, another stupid little, like she's going to go and get attacked, which sort of did happen, but in the end it made...
Did.
Yeah, well, sort of. it did end up kind of a stupid thing to do, but I liked the little mission that, I think it worked.
There's only so much character development you can get out of finding shelter and gathering water and clearing houses and getting supplies. Sometimes you need to do some stupid shit to really like show the audience who these characters are or were or can be.
Yeah,
I think.
Well, I really like that motive of like stupid little things because, well, first of all, Beth is growing up, so she's still like discovering, you know, this is her first drink. So she's doing these stupid little things that you kind of, like, we do those now. We kind of take it for granted, and you kind of discover who you are when you're doing those dumb little things. And I think Daryl's a little resentful because he talks about his life finally, and we discover he didn't get those opportunities. He never had time to do those stupid little things. He never had someone to watch his back for him.
Yeah.
And maybe that's why he was so angry for most of the episode.
Yeah, seeing her life post-apocalypse being better than his life pre-apocalypse has got to hurt him on a pretty fundamental level. So I thought it was interesting that they went with the peach schnapps. The fact that he called her like it was stupid college girl stuff, you would have thought that she would have enthusiastically drank that. Mm-hmm. But we were talking before the show, it is pretty ironic that his choice for a better first drink is moonshine.
It's what
he
knows.
I think that kind of shows that like her instinct is, oh, I'll go to the country club and find like a wine cooler or something like that. And his is like, we're going to a shack in the woods. We're going to drink moonshine. Yeah. Kind of shows the two characters like that.
She drank the moonshine like it was nothing, by the way. She was chugging that all night, perfectly fine. She's like a 110-pound non-drinker.
She can sip isn't so bad.
Yeah, right.
Maybe it wasn't even moonshine. Maybe it was just bottled water and he was just, like, you can convince yourself you're getting drunk even if you're not.
Made me think that the writers of the show haven't actually tried moonshine.
I don't think a lot of people have,
actually. No, I can't expect
moonshine.
Them to, but like, I know that the smell.
What is it like?
I mean, I've had grain alcohol before.
I haven't had backwoods moonshine, but I've had like the kind that you can get at a liquor store, and it's pretty foul. Yeah. It's kind of like jet fuel.
The smell alone punches you in the face. You don't just take a little sip and then put it down and like consider your next one.
So, like, obviously we have a lot of things that we're going to talk about, but while we're talking about, like, following urges, I think all of us expected that there was the possibility of them hooking up.
I really didn't want it to happen.
I really wanted it to happen.
No, he's too old for her, John.
He's not that old. He just has the hair. If he cut it, like, got a crew cut, he'd look young and fresh.
He's, like, 45.
I guess, but she's 20.
18.
No, you guys.
It's post-apocalyptic. You can't wait.
I guess that's true.
They need something to live for, and something to live for is physical contact.
I like Daryl with Michonne or Carol.
He's not going to be Michonne.
If your mindset is, oh my God, I need to have a drink before I die, it only follows that your second thought is,
I need to have sex before I die.
Yeah, maybe.
Especially as they're playing the game talking about the things they've never done. I thought that was, first of all, I thought she wanted to get drunk so that she would be bold enough to go to jump on him. And the never have I ever, or the weird version of it, I thought was going to be, well, I've never actually had sex. Well, maybe that's a deleted scene.
Have you ever gotten drunk and done something you'd regretted?
Yeah! that was her bringing it up, I think.
Oh.
So why didn't he jump on it, man?
Because he's a respectable man, unlike you.
And
because
he's an angry drunk.
She's into him! That's respectable!
And also, she's way better at holding her liquor, apparently, than he is.
I guess.
Which is a little weird.
He's a bad drunk, by the way.
He's mean!
And that was not just mean. It was, well, I guess, look, he's in a semi-suicidal mood, but screaming and just wandering outside as if there couldn't possibly be more than one zombie. That's pretty crazy. They're lucky they didn't get eaten.
His aim was not affected by that alcohol. He was hitting the corner pockets, all over the place.
I guess. I don't know. I did feel like, the zombie that attacked her in the country club is the most ineffectual zombie that's ever lived. Like, he was holding her arm. Like, they can pull open your skin.
I liked that one because it reminded me of that movie Idle Hands.
Interesting.
And Seth Green's character is a zombie with a bottle jammed into his skull for the whole movie.
That's right. Yeah. Maybe it was a
I'm
callback
just
to that.
It was a fun movie, right?
A young Jessica Alba.
Yes. But let's get back on track.
Yeah. But about the danger really fast, I did very much like the first scene where they decide to hide in the trunk.
I really
trunk.
Liked it. We got that zombie suspense back.
Yeah, that could have been the last decision they made, because if she had made a sound and they kept going to her and it looked like she was going to say something, that could have easily killed both of them. So I liked that scene. That was good.
They could have done an homage to Jurassic Park, though, and said, we'll be safe here. Unless they've learned how to open trunks.
That's true.
Well, she's a clever girl, and they didn't find them. What did we think of that scene outside the house? Daryl kind of reveals the mythos behind Daryl Dixon, who he was before the turn, and he was nothing, according to him. And I think that's really interesting, because it shows kind of how their roles and perception of usefulness switched. Because before, Beth had everything. She wasn't rich, but she had a family, and she was telling the story about how she can look forward to her father getting old, and Maggie and Glenn having a baby, and they would have picnics, and that's so sweet. That's what it makes life nice. And he didn't have any of that, but now he's this man who is indispensable. Mm. And he will be the last man standing, as she says, and she kind of admits, I'm going to die, you're going to miss me. She seems really good at confronting the truth suddenly.
Yeah. Well, I mean, she has had a harder transition in some ways than he has. His situation has actually sort of improved since the end of the world. He's not being bullied, he's thinking on his own, he's been at one point or another surrounded by a group of people who appreciate him and trust him and stuff like that. And that maybe is why it freaks him out so much when he feels responsible for them all dying by not confronting the governor or something like that. He actually lost a family that's unlike anything he's had, whereas they've all had some other family in the past that they've lost. Mm-hmm. They've been sort of, I guess, they don't feel it in the same way that he does. But the thing is, so she talks about him being, how he's going to be the last man standing, and I'm sure that makes him feel better on some some level.
No, it makes him feel terrible. He'll be alone again.
But I don't think he will be the last man standing, and not because he can't deal with the world the way it is, although when he gets drunk, he does risky stuff. But I think that he will become connected to another person, possibly Beth, if they continue this character arc, and he's the sort of guy who dies not because he's not prepared, but because he sacrifices himself to save another person. And so this could be foreshadowing him either trying to save her, or possibly she dies and he does something stupid because
really
he misses her.
I felt this was foreshadowing that she will die, because she came to terms with it. She seems to understand that it's going to happen, and that she already brought out the weight of her leaving.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, on this show, character development is the most terminal thing you can come down with.
Yes.
So, I mean, we're getting
Herschel
a lot of that.
Herschel had that great episode right before the end.
And I think it's also important to remember that, like, although we expect all these people to deal with the zombie apocalypse that's happening all around them with maturity and grace and, like, cool heads and quick thinking, like, she's a teenager. Her father was just murdered in front of her. She's allowed to be a little rebellious and want to get out of the suck-ass camp and go find a drink. I can't fault her for those things.
She did say suck-ass.
Yeah. Like, I get it. And I get the scene at the end too, however stupid it was.
Yeah. Did you dislike that scene with the blowing up house? Besides the inaccuracy, as I've learned, that Moonshine doesn't react that way.
Yeah.
Thank you, Moonshine
expert. I'm fine with them doing that, but do it in the morning after you've slept in the house. I don't want to walk around in the dark. I guess it's about following urges like getting the drink.
And again, another big metaphor. It wasn't exactly subtle of letting go of what's behind you and moving forward and being unafraid and realizing these harsh truths and giving the Daryl Dixon salute to everything, which I can't do on the air.
Can't we? This is the internet.
And about the house really fast, this is just a prep for the zombie apocalypse thing, but assuming you're not worried about humans, why don't they sleep on the roofs of these houses? Because that seems like the safest possible place. They can break into a house. They can't climb, though. Not generally. Consider that, Daryl.
Interesting.
Anyway, so overall, I did like it. I don't see them doing a lot of episodes like this just because they don't have the time for it. Like, there's too many different groups. Although the preview for next week did seem to indicate that they are going to be featured heavily in that episode. But I wonder, like, they're obviously building towards both Terminus and also The Cure. Mm-hmm. So I like that they're making time to actually flesh out the characters, but I feel like we can't expect too much more of this for this season.
Well, did you see the foreshadowing in the country club? How Beth finds that little spoon that says Washington, D.C. on it?
I couldn't read the spoon.
It's interesting that they didn't even imply where they might be headed, other than possibly the foreshadowing, but it wasn't like they found the things about Terminus or anything like that. Like, they're still just out there somewhere.
And they're places they've already been. This little shack was a place that he and Michonne already found, so they haven't gone far from the prison.
I think apparently. They're still in Georgia.
Yeah, that's a good guess. Yeah. It's also worth noting a theory that's going around on the internet right now, like a AMC One Universe theory. Obviously, Daryl tells the story about him and his brother and their tweaker, drug dealer friend that they almost got in a lethal argument with, and the way he describes him is very Jesse Pinkman-esque. He says, "I'm gonna kill you, bitch," and he's a skinny white drug dealer. So, I mean,
is there a talking dog cartoon on that show?
Well, he laments about his kid that he used to have. It could be talking about Brock. We don't know. Brock was watching cartoons.
God. Well, I already had a theory that someone tried to recreate the blue meth, and it caused a bath salts effect and caused this whole thing. So,
and I think all they need to do to solidify the theory is add a zombified half-faced Gus Fring walking around in the background somewhere.
That'd be so good.
I love it.
Okay, interesting theory.
What were your guys' thoughts on the Mountain Goat song that ended the
I don't know video. The significance of the song, to be honest.
I believe it's a retelling of the Romulus and Remus fable, the founding of Rome, how they were abandoned by their parents and raised by wolves and went on to do great things.
Okay.
It's maybe a little heavy-handed with the whole, forget our past, we're
so
burning this down.
They're brothers now and not lovers.
Perhaps.
In this song, which is what I like.
Okay.
Next week we have the Bob, Sasha, Maggie triangle to flesh out. They're in the fog fighting, and maybe that trio will make more sense like this duo did this week. Be sure to check in next week for a review of episode 13. Thanks, y'all.